Ladies and gentlemen, good day and welcome to Torrent Power Limited 2Q FY 2022 conference call hosted by IIFL Securities Limited. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode. There will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal for an operator by pressing star then zero on your touchtone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Harshvardhan Dole from IIFL Securities. Thank you, and over to you.
Thank you, Zed. Greetings, everyone. On behalf of IIFL Securities, I welcome you all for the second quarter earnings call of Torrent Power. To discuss the 2Q numbers in detail and share the performance outlook, we have the entire management team of Torrent Power. It's my privilege to introduce you to Saurabh Mashruwala, VP Finance, Rishi Shah, GM Finance, and Jaiprakash Khanwani, AGM Finance. I would first request the management to make opening remarks, subsequent to which we can open the floor for Q&A. Over to you, Saurabh bhai.
Thank you, Harsh. Good morning to all of you. Thank you for joining earnings call of Torrent Power for Q2 FY 2022. First, I will take you through the performance of the quarter, after which phone lines will be open for Q&A session. I'll explain the performance of the company at PBT level first. Reported PBT for the quarter stood at 485 crores as compared to 230 crores in corresponding quarter last year. It is increased by about 255 crores, 111% on reported basis. There are no one-off items in the course of the current quarter, but as you would recollect that reported PBT of corresponding quarter of Q2 FY 2021 was carrying three one-off items. The first one is there was a provision of about 100 crores towards doubtful debt mainly in franchise distribution business due to lower collection efficiency owing to the COVID. Second, there was under-recovery about fuel cost of 42 crores in new fusion project, which got reversed in Q3 of FY 2021. Lastly, there was an increase of 21 crores arising from CERC tariff order for the control period of 2019-2024 for our fusion power project. All put together, there was net non-recurring charges of 121 crores in Q2 of FY 2021, which is last year. Adjusted for this one-off, PBT for the quarter stood at 485 crores compared to 351 crores in the comparable quarter last year, which is higher by 134 crores, that is 38%. Now I will take you to the key highlights on improvement in the PBT for the current quarter. First, I will update you about the various positives which has contributed to the this increase in the profit. I will update about the two negatives also, which has reduced the profit. First is there is a substantial reduction in T&D losses, mainly in distribution franchise business due to restoration of industrial demand, which was significantly impacted last year due to COVID-19 pandemic. The positive impact of this development is 70 crores. Second is higher PLF from renewable projects, mainly due to abnormally low wind speed witnessed during the last year. This has also contributed 46 crores positively to the profit. The third is gross reduction in finance costs for the quarter by 44 crores. This is mainly because of lower rate of interest and average lower level of debt. Interest rate for the quarter was lower by 90 basis points compared to corresponding quarter of last year. The average debt level also as on 30th September 2021 was lower at 7,469 crores compared to 8,734 crores, which is lower by 1,265 crores. Our debt level has gone down by 1,265 crores. The fourth reason is increase in contribution for franchise distribution, mainly due to the higher demand. This has contributed about 13 crores in the profitability. I will talk about there are three reasons which has reduced the profit of the company. First is annual recovery of annual fixed cost of fusion plant due to reduction in long-term PPA with PTC Limited, PTC, from 75 megawatt to 50 megawatt, which has impacted the profitability by 5 crores. The second is the increased depreciation due to incremental capex with the previous quarter, which has impacted the profitability by 15 crores. And that is an increase in salary and O&M cost by 10 crores. So these are the reasons which has contributed, which has impacted the profitability of the company. Then the demand in the both license as well as franchise distribution area have improved by 19% and have almost reached a pre-COVID level, mainly due to the relaxation given by the government from COVID in COVID-induced lockdown and reopening of the economic activity in the quarter, in the country. We expect year likely to be ended with the demand reaching to the pre-COVID level of FY20. Moving on to the PAT number, considered PAT reported for the quarter was 367 crores as compared to 204 crores reported in the corresponding quarter last year, which is higher by 163 crores, of about 80%. So this completes the overview of the quarterly operating performance of the company. Now I will move to the update. I will move and give you an update about the current projects which are in line. During the quarter, company has entered a share purchase agreement CSE and their associate company to 56 megawatt of 4 wind power projects located in state of Gujarat, Rajasthan and Madhya Pradesh. The key details of the project have already been shared by stock exchange submissions. Moving on to the other projects, first is 115 megawatt CT5 project, which we have received extension of SCOD from February 22, September 22. So we got some additional time to commission the project up to February 22. EPC contract has already been awarded for this project, and project is likely to commission during FY23. The second is the SCOD of 100 megawatt GUVNL project is also extended to October 22 from July 22. The third is 300 megawatt of TPLD project. SCOD of this also is extended to December 22 from November 22. As you know, the AP project is still subjudice. There is no progress in the AP project. Respect to take over license distribution business of Union Territory of Dadra, Nagar Haveli, Daman and Diu, as informed in the last call, Supreme Court has vacated the stay imposed by the Bombay High Court on the tender process, and we are awaiting the data hearing from the Supreme Court. Now I would request the coordinator to open the line for Q&A session. We wish everybody to stay safe and healthy. Handing over to operator. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking questions. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. To ask a question, please press star and one. The first question is from the line of Aniket Mittal from SBI Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Yes, thank you for the opportunity. So I actually had a question on the fuel tie-up for our gas-based plants and the recent rise that we've seen in energy prices. So if you could highlight one, what is the current extent now of our tie-ups for these gas-based plants? And secondly, maybe from a near-term perspective, what are the measures that you have been taking or you can take to cushion yourselves if the current environment sustains on LNG?
Yeah, Aniga, thank you so much. First, I will talk about this power purchase. If you have look at the current scenario in the country about the action prices, which has we have witnessed about a very high price in mid-October, about 15 rupees kind of a things. Then because of the coal shortage and demand has picked up also. But if you look at last 1 week time, where we have seen some normalcy in the power purchase price, power price in power exchange, which have last 2-3 days, it has also reached to see about 3.5 rupees kind of a thing. So we expect that things are going to be normalized in terms of as far as the power purchase price in the country is concerned. That is what our expectation is. And we are also entering the winter also. So the festival season is there. Winter is also there. Demand will be lower as compared with the September, October kind of a thing. So power purchase price is back to normal. That is what we can say right now. In terms of gas, particularly the international price, if you look at the current situation, is unprecedented. Firstly, there are some certain development in terms of supply side. There are supply side disruption, and demand is also has increased in a significant way. So which has impacted the, which has vitiated the demand supply position of LNG in the international market. So we hope that this situation will continue till the winter, which is to be likely to be over by March 22. Which time things should become normal. That is what our expectation is, because this kind of a price is not sustainable. About $30 plus kind of a price is not sustainable, and it has reached the parity of the with the Brent also. Like for example, if you look at consider $11 low, and $80 are good price. About $8.8 kind of a price should be there for the LNG, which is not at that, which is not at current level. So we expect the parity will come down, will come post winter. So our expectation is post winter things should improve, and we can see some normal level of LNG prices. That is what our expectation is. In terms of our tie-up, we have a contract up to calendar year December 22. So for beyond December 21, I would say beyond December 21. We have recently in the month of August floated tenders for the LNG procurement for next 5 years. We have sought the quote for 34 cargoes. Out of 34 cargoes, we got some offers from various vendors. And since the spot price was higher, the offer was not offer was on a higher side. So we were contracted about 3 cargoes for next 4 years, I would say, from 20 to 26. And 22, we still have to contract the cargo. But in terms of our tie-up, we have a tie-up, we have a gas tie-up here, IOCL as well as Reliance, which is about 25% of our requirement for our long-term PPA requirement. So with this tie-up of 2 cargoes, we have contracted 25% of the medium-term requirement for our PPA. So balance requirement, we will wait till April, things become normalized, and then we will tie up the gas for the balance period. So this is what the situation about the gas. So current situation of gas is unprecedented, not sustainable, and it is likely to come down post winter. That is what our expectation is.
So just one follow up on that, if I may. So like you rightly said, there is some, I think, tie ups that we have on the domestic front as well, but how much of that is getting supplied? So maybe on an MMSCMD basis, what is the quantum of MMSCMD basis that we receive on a domestic basis, which I think would be APM level?
It is about 25% of our requirement for long-term PPA, like for about TPLD and PTC requirement.
So we're getting that supply from the
domestic. We are getting that supply. So it is covering about 25% of our long-term PPA requirements. LNG we have tied up, or few cargoes we have tied up very recently, it also add up to the another 25%.
So the 3 cargoes that you're talking about, that you've tied up?
Yeah, 3 cargoes for each year, I would say. Starting from 23, calendar 23.
So just one more question. On the collection efficiencies for your distribution franchise circle, if you could highlight how are the collections in Bhiwandi and Agra right now moving? Because in the past, I think we've done some excess provisioning of around 130 crores, and I think none of that has reversed in this quarter. So if you could throw some light over there and how we see things progressing.
Even if there are small reversals, but not significant, I would say. But collection efficiency overall is more than 100% for the quarter in terms of Bhiwandi and Agra. Bhiwandi and SNK, I would say. Agra is about 98% kind of efficiency we have achieved. So, but in terms of T&D loss, we have made a significant progress in terms of T&D losses. So for example, we have our T&D losses was about 14.4% for the quarter. it was about 22% comparable quarter of last year. In terms of Agra, we have achieved a team yield of 9.36%, which was about 10.83% of comparable quarter last year. So in terms of T&A losses, we have achieved a significant progress, and the major drivers, I would say, for profitability for this quarter is the T&A losses, and the franchise is the license distribution area.
Understood. Thank you. That's it from me.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Next question is on the line of Mohit Kumar from DAM Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good morning, sir, and congratulations on a good set of numbers. The first question was a bookkeeping question. So do we have, can you give us a breakup of profits at EBITDA level business-wise, which you give every quarter?
Yeah, I can give the EBITDA breakup of this Q2. For example, gas is 809 crores as compared to 821 crores last year. And renewable project has improved a lot. 650.
Just a second. No, sorry.
Yeah, EBITDA number of Q2 gas is 189 crores. I am repeating again. 189 crores versus 175 crores. Renewable project is 226 crores versus 180 crores. License distribution is about 341 crores versus 352 crores. And franchise distribution about 220 crores versus 153 crores. And total EBITDA before one-off, I would say, is 974 crores versus 870 crores. If you
Understood. Add
one-off, basically, if you reduce the one-off, 121 crores last year, then reported EBITDA will be 974 crores for the quarter and 748 crores for the last year, similar quarter.
Yes, sir. Second is, sir, you've done a lot of acquisition, started a number of acquisition for renewable power plants. So what are the kind of equity returns possible after taking all the improvements you need to make it more efficient? And secondly, and related question is that, what is the long-term plan for the renewable portfolio? Are you looking for some kind of listing or invite or something else? And the kind of target and the kind of any gigawatt number you are targeting, let's say, next few years down the line?
Well, we said in the previous quarter, we have about 5,000 megawatt of renewable plan for next 4-5 years, I would say. That is what we generally, our target is. And we are aiming for what 13% IRR, equity IRR from the renewable project. And we are, yes,
on
we
the
are.
Portfolio too, is the number correct?
Sorry?
On the acquisition pipeline, we can expect a similar number.
So Mohit, what we are trying to say is that as a target right now, if you look at our existing capacity, including the projects which you have under pipeline, that is around 2 gigawatts, which we expect to enhance it to 5 gigawatts over a period of time, let's say next 3 to 4 years. That's what the expectations are. Now that could be in the form of a greenfield, or that could be in the form of acquisitions. We have not closed our options. We are looking at both the options. But the target is to expand our portfolio to 5 gigawatts over a period of next 3 to 4 years.
And so lastly, what is the status of Daman and Diu bid? Is there any update which you can share with us?
Yeah, Daman and Diu, we explained that it is matter of Supreme Court. We expect hearing to happen in Supreme Court. Post this, government will expect it to issue the LOA for the Daman and Diu, and then we can, post receipt of the LOA, we can take over the Daman and Diu. So we are awaiting the hearing from Supreme Court.
Understood, sir. Thank you, and best of luck, sir. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Next question is on the line of Rahul Modi from ICICI Securities. Please go ahead.
Thank you for the opportunity. Sir, a quick couple of questions. Sir, is there any update on the SECI 3 500 megawatts there's no chance of that coming back. And secondly, sir, a little bit more in the gas sourcing. So you mentioned that we booked three cargoes. So just to understand, so what are the rates that we are getting currently under the medium term that you had gone for? And secondly, sir, what happens to your plant availability for Sugen and Uno Sugen in a situation where gas prices beyond December remain at more than $10 to $12? If you can just highlight. Thank you.
As far as CKLEG is concerned, there is no further update. It is we are not going ahead with the project. So that is what the current update is. And as far as gas type is concerned, we have contracted three cargoes for next 4 years, I would say, 2026. At a very reasonable, I think, good slope, I would say. So we will not be able to exactly update you about the what slope we have contracted, but it is a very, very good slope we have contracted the three cargoes each year. That is what the current update is. And what was the last question?
Sir, it was more on the plant availability for both Sugen and Uno Sugen post December, how we are planning to do.
Plant availability is concerned, we generally have a 100% plant availability in terms of readiness of the for generation for both Sugen as well as Uno Sugen project. So in terms of availability, we don't see any issue. Fuel, yes, we have some 25% fuels available. So balance we will tie up as per the requirement. So and, the availability is ensured in terms of plant availability.
No, I'm saying the availability is more to do with including fuel. So beyond December, the 25% that you mentioned domestic, you will split it between Uno Sugen and Sugen, or how will you be going about it?
So Rahul, the issue is if you have availability, the gas is plenty available in the market. So the availability should not be an issue. The issue here is of pricing. As far as availability is concerned, there should not be any issue of declaring the availability of both the plants.
Okay, because Uno Sugen had some conditions. That's what the understanding was.
Yeah, Uno Sugen condition was the price, total price, variable as well as fixed price cost should not exceed the midterm price. That is what medium term price, I would say. That is what the condition was. But if you look at the, since the VVA, if we are ensuring the availability and we are ensuring that the fuel is available, plant is available, then this PPA is approved under Section 62, which is a cost plus tariff, two-part tariff. So, and all PPA which is being approved across the country under Section 62, where once you establish the availability of the plant in terms of fuel availability, in terms of plant availability, the fixed cost is being passed through. So we don't expect that the any issue will be there in terms of pass through the fixed cost in terms of for Sugen as well as Uno Sugen project.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Next question is from the line of Apoorva Bahadur from Investec. Please go ahead.
Hey, hi there. Congratulations on a strong set of numbers and thank you so much for the opportunity. Harping on the gas tie-up again, just wanted to understand for this FY23, by when latest do we need to have this gas tie-up so that the plants operate? Is there a lag typically between a tie-up and gas becoming available at our plants?
Gas, it's a continuous process. In fact, we are in the market for the sourcing of the gas. So, and current calendar year 22, we have 25% gas available. So, we expect that the price will stabilize post winter. And by that time, we will be able to procure more. We will tap the market and procure more gas.
Sure, sir. And sir, can Uno Sugen also use this domestic gas, or that is exclusively for the PPAs of Sugen?
No, we can use the domestic gas also. In fact, we are getting domestic gas in Uno Sugen project from Reliance. So we are getting the gas for from Reliance for Uno Fusion project.
Okay, fair enough. So second question is on this Amgen retirement. So with this recent spike in prices which we saw on the exchange and generally gas being so costly, are there any expectations of an extension over there?
As of now, there is no such news, but yes, if there is a shortage of the power in the country, government may consider, but we, as of now, there is no such clarity.
Okay, fair enough. Sir, lastly, if I may ask, and on this, on the loss reduction at SMK, that has not been as sharp as some of our other distribution franchisees, despite the loss levels being quite high. So what sort of a trajectory should we look at over there for loss, from a loss reduction point of view?
If you look at the loss, as compared with the last Q2, we have reduced about 2% loss in the last over 1 year, I would say. So, and we are there in the SMK in last, since last 1 year, and that also during the COVID, we couldn't able to invest significantly in SMK as per our plan. So now we have started investing. We are putting this network underground. We are undergrounding a network, started undergrounding a network. We are ramping up the our efforts in terms of centering the network. So we expect a good reduction in SMK P&D losses going forward.
Okay. So just lastly, on this smart metering scheme of the government, do we see any capex opportunity in our distribution license business from this?
Which scheme?
So the smart metering scheme.
I don't think so.
Not in it. Okay. Thank you so much, sir. Have a good.
Thank you very much. Next question is on the line of Devam Moti from Ardeco Capital. Please go ahead.
Hello, sir. Thanks for the opportunity. Just wanted to understand with regards to the current environment. Obviously, we also discussed on the call regarding the power shortages. We would expect that whenever there are such abrupt power shortages, typically gas-based power remains area wherein people rely to for sourcing their short-term requirements. While on a year-on-year basis, if we see actually the utilization of gas-based power has actually dipped. So if you can just highlight the various nitty-gritties involved in this and what will it take in terms of for us to get a higher, let's say, merchant volume or shorter-term volume on the gas-based front in terms of an overall environment?
In terms of plant operation, I would say the gas plant power that is very ideally placed for to start the operation as compared with the coal based power project. So that is one advantage we have in terms of running the plant gas based power project. So in terms of, but important is the fuel availability and that at what price fuel is available. So that because this is the current opportunity, the very appropriate opportunity for gas plus power project to come to run the power project, but at the same time, the interest of gas price has gone up so much that it's not comparable, I would say, competitive in terms of current domestic power price. So yes, it is ideally placed to run the gas power project in the current situation when there is a huge coal shortage and power price has gone up to 50 rupees kind of a thing.
And Devam, just to add to him, gas, you can start gas-based power plant at a very short notice, but the issue is that the entire ecosystem has to be available to start the gas-based power plant. So a lot of power plants in the country are as of now stranded. So you can't start those plants at a short notice. If a power plant is running and you have availability of fuel, then only you can start the plant. So compared to all other power plants, our power plants are up and running and in a ready state. But because of the prices which were very high, the use of power plants was not that high, or the PLF of the gas-based power plants was not that high. So if it is a plant is stranded, you need a couple of months of preparation to start the power plant. And this the spike which we saw in current merchant markets was very sporadic and very fast, which nobody had anticipated. And that's why you have seen that the gas-based power plants were not able to contribute to that.
Yes, so basically, the one clear-cut indicator which people saw of the higher prices, which all of us could see, were the prices which were there on the energy exchange. Now, those prices indicated much higher levels. So, would that be a broad proxy of the kind of pricing which was prevailing, or you would say that on bulk, when the SEBs come to the sourcing, or when probably your plant should get would be selling the power, the actual power price would be much lower?
No. So the prices which you saw on the exchanges were short-term kind of prices, which again have gone back to the original levels of 3-3.5 rupees. So such kind of short-term price hikes may not be addressed only by gas-based power plants if you don't have the fuel.
Okay, and a rough conversion, let's say, if we say that fuel is available on a very rough rule of thumb, that if fuel is available at $10 per MMBTU, your variable cost will come to roughly around five rupees per unit. Would that be a rough number to take at $75 USD INR?
5.5 you can consider.
So 0.55 would be the ratio for converting from USD.
Yeah.
Okay. And from what we recall earlier, this used to be like 0.45, and currency has only depreciated by like around 10% from those levels. So would there be a difference in the heat rates, or what is it that has changed?
Heat rate won't make. No, it was never 0.45 Devam. It was always between 0.5 to 0.6.
Okay. And also on the gas-based plants, what we were also made to understand was that there would be ideal proxies for clubbing with renewable power because of the RTC issues that renewable power faces. So any thoughts or any progress on that front with regards to a government policy for the same, for the renewable power or for peaking? Because we have been hearing of that since a couple of years, that something is in the works, but we have not seen anything in terms of any draft paper or anything. So any thoughts on those funds?
Government is working on it, but nothing is on the ground right at this moment.
Okay. And also there is
this concept also. Government talk about this concept, but nothing has come so far and nothing is on the ground for this particular concept.
Okay, because we do see talks of these kind of things in several power manufacturers like ABB or Cummins, or those kind of guys are also talking about these kind of things, but still it is not happening through government policy. So, I mean, what you are saying is that there is no such talk in the government, there is no such thing which is coming out from the government as of now.
Yes, but important is that fuels at reasonable price should be available for the gas. I think government is working towards that. How can they make the fuel available to the gas-based power plants at a reasonable cost.
Okay. And then finally, there is this separation of carriage and content, which is probably in advanced stages or at a certain level. So how does that affect us? And in our case in particular, since there will be a lot of areas adjacent to our current license distribution area, wherein we could tap into if we get a separation of carriage and content. Do you see it as an opportunity for Torrent, or how would that work out?
Basically, de-licensing, for example, de-licensing will give a good opportunity for Torrent Canapa players, where we have a very strong hold on the distribution. We can go and, because nobody will come to Ahmedabad, for example, duplication of network in Ahmedabad would be difficult for a new player. So, but we can go and tie some new areas, urban areas, kind of a new rural area kind of a thing, near to our areas also. It will give a good opportunity for us to go and expand for our distribution area business.
Sure. And what are the timelines we see on this? Because a lot of talks have been happening on this front.
Yeah.
What will be the timelines over here?
Last parliament session, government supposed to bring the bill, but I don't think it hasn't happened. So we are awaiting on this particular front from the government.
Yeah, okay, sure. That's it from my side. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, in order to ensure that the management is able to address queries from all participants, you are requested to restrict your questions to 2 per participant. Time permitting, you may return to the queue for your follow-up questions. The next question is from the line of Shubhadeep Mitra from JM Financial. Please go ahead.
Good morning and thank you for the opportunity. So just going back to, the conversation around the fuel cost and, the tariffs. So our sense is that for the Unosugen PPA, there is a price cap of around 4.4, which implies a gas price of maybe closer to around $7 odd. So as per our math, what we're seeing is, you know, once you move closer to a $9 kind of a number, you will probably start seeing, variable cost under recovery is also not just fixed cost. So just wanted to get a sense from you that, you know, assuming that the gas prices stabilize even around $9 or $10, what kind of impact would one be seeing on Unosugen? Would you be start seeing the fixed cost under recoveries playing out over there?
If you look at the Unosugen PPA was approved under Section 62, which is a cost plus tariff. So two-part tariff, I would say. So if you look at the all PPAs which is approved in the country under Section 62, fixed cost is pass. We have to ensure that the plant is available, fuel is available. And we don't see any, both are available in our case. Both should be available in our case. Fuel also it should be available, though it is a bit expensive. But so we don't see any much issue on recovery of the fixed cost.
So the cap of that 4.4 odd is that including the fixed cost? Because that was our understanding.
Yeah, it is. 4.4 is fixed, is variable cost only. Fixed cost is 1.1 rupee over and above that, which is about 228 crores kind of a thing.
Understood. So would I then be looking at potentially a 6.2 kind of a number as the cap, including the fixed cost?
No, about 4.28 plus 1.10. That is what the total cost.
Correct. So
5.5 rupees kind of a thing.
About 5.4, yeah. 5.38 is the number. So 5.38 is the effective cap, right? Both put together. So assuming assuming your variable costs are higher, would you be looking at a scenario that you would voluntarily want to shut down the plant? Or are you saying that I will always keep, even if I'm buying gas at $15 and my plant is available to produce, you would still see fixed cost recovery? Because, it's a bit of a quandary, right? Because if, let's say, you're showing gas availability at, let's say, whatever, $14 or $15, and you're running the plant, and the price cap is, let's say, 5.4, you will actually start making under recovery. So, which is why I'm asking the question.
So, Subhadeep, so what we are trying to say is that if, let's say, price of gas is uneconomical, which should not be passed on to the consumers, we will still show the availability of the plant, which will allow us to pass on the fixed cost. As Saurabh explained, that it is a Section 62 PPA, which means your fixed cost recovery is dependent upon the you declaring the plant availability. So if you are declaring availability of plant, but it is not getting scheduled because your gas price is very high and because of which the variable price is very high, you still be getting the fixed cost. That is what our expectations is.
Okay, so you're not looking at a scenario that the DISCOM will ask you to produce, since you're anyway showing availability. It's not a scenario where DISCOM will ask you to produce the power and sell it to him at this price cap of 5.4, regardless of where gas prices are going. So that is not a contention.
No, that is what not. No.
That scenario is there for Section 63 PPAs, not Section 62 PPAs.
Section 62 PPA, yes.
Okay, so good. This is a good clarity on this point. Thank you. Secondly, on the same point, on Sugen, would you be looking at a scenario where I understand that that's a ROE-based PPA and you will show availability, but currently you do earn a lot of these SHR and other efficiency-related benefits. So my understanding is that assuming that plant is not getting any drawal of power because of higher gas prices, you might actually start seeing, let's say, the profit number there coming to, closer to only about 100 odd crores, which is the normalized regulated ROE, instead of a higher number that you earn today. Are these numbers more or less correct?
If you are not generating, yes, there will be a reduction, means loss in terms of fuel efficiency again.
So only impact would be the SHR savings which we make if you are running the plant. If you are not running the plant, the savings from SHR savings would not accrue to us.
Yes.
That would be the impact on the profitability.
There is no other impact in terms of Sujan PPA.
Correct. So the base level ROE that Sujan would earn would be what? In the range of around 100-120 odd crores, assuming only the ROE and without any efficiency.
We are not sharing those numbers on a plant-on-plant basis, Subhadeep.
Okay. Okay. Understood. Perfect. These were my two questions. Thank you so much for the clarity.
Thank you very much. Next question is from the line of Noel from Ashika Group. Please go ahead.
Yes, sir. Actually, I just have one question regarding capex for the current quarter and for the full year and forward. And for the next 2 years, there has there been any changes?
Capex for the half year is in line, I would say. About we have incurred about 400 crores capex in license distribution area, and franchise we have incurred about we spent about 130 crores on capex in franchise distribution area. As far as guidance is concerned, our annual for next 3 years, including the current year, is 1,200 crores for license distribution area and about 250 crores in for our franchise distribution area. The guidance is continuing.
Okay. That is one thing. Also, just one more thing I was just wanted to know. So, regarding the plan for RE, I just wanted to just confirm. So, this plan that we have to add around 5 gigawatts of RE, so that is including both organic and inorganic, right?
Yes, both organic and as well as inorganic.
Okay, fine. Yeah, that is all my question. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Next question is from the line of Aman Madrecha from Augmenta Research Private Limited. Please go ahead.
Yes, sir. So just I wanted to ask, like out of the total distribution and generation, what proportion is the regulated equity and what is the merchant power plant? And the second one is, can you just give an outlook on the DGEN power plant? Do we expect the demand to come back from the DGEN power plant, or the scenario is going to remain the same over the next few years?
In terms of DGEN power plant, we expect the demand in the country will remain strong because of the pure GDP growth as well as the electric demand. So, but the currently the fuel is a bit challenging because of the we believe that the post April 22 fuel prices will cool down and will go to the sustainable level. So it all depends on the what kind of the fuel and what fuel is available for the diesel plant.
And also, sir, on the my first question, like what is the proportion of regulated equity and what is the proportion of merchant power plant in our thermal and that thing, distribution?
For example, in terms of gas-based power exclusion, for example, we have 1.41 megawatt of capacity, out of which 835 megawatt is for our TPLD distribution and about 50 megawatts of for PTC. The balance is more merchant capacity. In terms of Suno Sujan, about out of 382 megawatt, 278 megawatt is for our TPLD. And balance is the merchant capacity.
Okay, and and just on the renewable side, there is no regulated equity, right?
It's all fully tied. All PPAs are there, so it's all. There is no merchant kind of a thing in forest as far as renewable is concerned.
Okay, and so going forward, are we expecting the renewable capacity we are expanding, so that would be under again the merchant or the regulated equity, whichever capacities are coming going forward?
It will be against the PPA with the maybe the SECI or the state discount. So it will be fully tied up, I would say. So that is where we don't do anything for the merchant. That is. So it will be the state discom or the city kind of a organization.
Okay, got it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Next question is from the line of Sumit Kishore from Axis Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi, good morning. Thanks for the opportunity. My first question is that at prevailing solar panel prices, the two PPAs that you've signed with UVNL and TPLD for 1.99 and 2.22, when are you going to award the contracts, and do you see the company meeting the 2022 timeline, October and December, for these two projects? So, at prevailing module prices, would you go ahead with these projects?
So we are awaiting the things to be normalized. So we know that the prices have gone up as compared to what we have budgeted, projected. So we have a time. So we have not yet decided to place the order for the module. So we are awaiting the price to stabilize, and then we'll take our decision forward.
Completion in October, you'll have to place your contract over what time frame to get delivery and execute the project?
So, we can award modules or can procure modules 3 months before that also, if you have all other things in place. So we are working on it, how to make this project or construct this project. As of now, so clarity is still not available when module prices will come down. But as far as the question is concerned, you can get it done in 3 months' time also, if you have other things in place in terms of land or evacuation and transmission. So we are working on those aspects to keep us in ready state condition, so that if module price is correct, we may be able to get order those modules. But as of now, clarity is not available when these module prices are going to correct.
My second question is on the Bhiwandi T&D loss trajectory. There seems to be a quarter-on-quarter increase from 11.6% to 13.1%. And I would have assumed that because COVID disruption has petered out, this should have reduced.
Bhiwandi, in terms of
from June quarter to September quarter, I'm looking at the T&D loss figure that you gave in your presentation. It's 13.1% as of September, and it was 11.6% in June.
No, so I think quarter on quarter, looking at AT&T losses may not be so relevant. You'll have to see on a YTD basis, because there are certain changes or certain estimates which we make on in terms of T&T losses are concerned. So ideal way to look at it is on a YTD basis rather than on a quarter on quarter basis. The expectation is that for my franchise distribution business, we would be more or less in line with what we have seen T&D losses pre-COVID levels or below that. So we are in that line. So if you look at from H1 to H1 perspective, H1 of FY22, B1D is at 13.07% of T&D losses, whereas H1 FY21 was 23%. So we have made quite a progress in terms of T&D losses are concerned. Quarter on quarter, there could be some aberrations, which we would like to avoid. So I think ideal way to look at it is on a YTD basis.
Got it. And just to understand your 5 gigawatt renewable portfolio target over a 3 to 4 year perspective, I mean, is this like, has this been laid out by the senior leadership, and have you thought out about how the mix of solar, wind in the overall portfolio is going to be? Or this is more like an aspiration that you are heading towards? Want to help you?
So I think we are agnostic to solar or wind. We would look at project to project on a very standalone basis. If it is meeting our criteria of internal hurdle rates, then we would definitely want to take up that project, either be it wind or solar. But it will all depend on what kind of IRRs they are giving us.
So this would be done on a project-to-project basis. I mean, there is no formal target as such.
No, so the aspirations are to grow to have 5,000 megawatts or 5 gigawatts by 2, 3, or 4 years down the line. But then it all depends on whether that is giving us our hurdle rates.
Sure. And 156 megawatt acquisition from CESC met the hurdle rate of mid to high teen IRR.
Yeah, so as we explained and on the CSE acquisition, is that
the PLF which we are looking at it right now are subdued because of certain issues there. We expect that we will be able to improve the IRRs, based on which it will, should meet our low teen to mid teen IRR expectations.
Low to mid teen. Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. The next question is from the line of Bharani Vijay Kumar from Spark Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good morning, gentlemen. So, this CSE's acquisition, when will it be consolidated?
We are hoping to conclude during the course of the quarter, this quarter.
Right. So, from the third quarter's results, it will be consolidated, is it?
That is why we are hoping. We have, there are some PPs to be concluded before to before the closing of the acquisition. So we are in the process of doing it. So we are, we hope to conclude the, all CSE to conclude all CPs by before end of this quarter.
Okay. And coming to the renewables addition, so two is what we have in operation and under construction, 2 gigawatts. So we are likely to add 3 more gigawatts over the next 3 to 4 years, and then reach 5 gigawatt at the end of it. Am I right?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Right. So regarding this renewables, and since most of it is going to be on a PPA basis, just trying to understand from a generator like you, the attractiveness of all these green products in the exchange markets that have been introduced. So would you be interested and use those products to sell your power? If not, why? Like your green term ahead market, green green dam products in exchanges.
Sarah, it's too early to comment on this. It just started recently. So we have not looked at it very thoroughly as of now. It's too early to comment on that.
Sure. So as of now, we are not using even green term ahead market. Okay.
No, we don't have any untied capacity.
We don't have untied capacity. All capacities are tied up with the long term PPA.
Oh, got it. Still, you know, there are generators who still use it. So just trying to understand if you have any such plans. Okay. So final question is on the gas tie up. So the requirement per year for Sugen and Unosugen together would be around 5 MMSCMD, like 4 for Sugen and about 1 for Unosugen.
About 3.2, I would say, not 3.2. Say as 5 to 6 MMSCMD depends on the PLF levels of both the plants.
Okay, why I ask Rishi is to find out what has been tied up of this 5, let's say it is the outside number. So you are telling for Unosugen, we have tied up from IOCL and Reliance. So that is fully taken care of.
Bharani, just to correct you, I think what we have said is that for our long-term PPA liabilities are concerned, we have tied up around 25% for both the plants, which is okay, from IOCL and Reliance. On top of it, as Sarabhai said earlier in the call, that we have floated a long-term tender to source international LNG from the market, wherein we have tied up 3 cargoes each year, starting from calendar year 23, which is roughly around 25% of our additional requirement. So that takes us to 50% of our requirement for both these plants under the PPA liabilities are concerned. Balance 50% is open, and calendar year 22 is also open, apart from the domestic. So domestic is available for 22 and going forward. International is from 23 calendar year and going forward.
Okay, so of this roughly 5 MMSCMD requirement, how much is coming from domestic for us right now?
25%.
So 75% is taken care.
No, I'm saying 25% is available from domestic market.
Correct. So 25% tied up through IOCL and Reliance, and another 25% from calendar 23 for, from international.
Yes,
so
right.
Only 25%, 50% open in calendar year 22 and 25% open in calendar year 23.
No.
75% open in calendar year 22 and 50% open for 23 onwards.
Okay. Understood. Okay, I think that's it from my side. All the best.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, that was the last question due to the paucity of time. I now hand over the conference to Mr. Harshvardhan Dole for closing comments. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. On behalf of IIFL Security, I thank you everyone for logging on to this call. A sincere thanks to the management for giving us an opportunity to host the call. Saurabh Bhai, Rishi Bhai, any last comments that you would like to make before we conclude this call?
Thank you so much to everybody and happy Diwali to everybody. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you very much, members of management. Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of IIFL Securities, that concludes today's conference call. Thank you all for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines.